Jose.
You're watching.
The President's Trophy winner. Exhale, British Columbia.
Everybody, welcome to the CBC Vancouver studios. I'm Jody Vance. Thanks for sticking around for this Western Conference Final Game 4 edition of Seeking Stanley. This is your destination for extended Canucks playoff post-game coverage, all of the player reaction from the rink in San Jose, and of course the coaches' pressers. But first, let's revisit some highlights, shall we? It is a big game, and the fans were out in full force, establishing the tempo early key in this Game 4. And by the look on Coach V's face, the first-minute penalty by Tanner Glass, not exactly part of the tempo plan. How the Canucks responded shorthanded, however, certainly would have been. Vancouver controlled the puck for most of the kill, even at a great shorthanded opportunity. It stays scoreless early. With just over 6 minutes to play in the first, Glass gets sent off again, this time for boarding on Ian White. The Sharks get their chances, but Luongo kills his third Shark power play of this game. It is still no score. San Jose with no shortage of opportunities, but the Canucks defense and ultimately Luongo successful on the PK. In the dying seconds, Rafi Torres runs over Douglas Murray, means the Sharks will start the second with the man advantage again. And here's Rafi feeling shame. And just as the Canucks kill that two-minute minor, Dan Hamhuis apparently did something to warrant another penalty. The Canucks kill off five so far, and we're just 4 minutes into the second, and it's still no score. Keith Ballard, a little payback for knocking out Aaron Rome there. McGinn, a nice big hit. Danny Heatley eclipses Cody Hodgson, and now the Canucks go to work to try and open the scoring. However, the Sharks' Torrey Mitchell trips up Daniel Sedin. It's a two-man advantage. And just 10 seconds later, Ryan Kessler gets the visitors on the board first. The power play, however, would continue. It's 1-0 Canucks here. Still with the man advantage, a too many men call on the Sharks sees Vancouver with another 5-on-3 opportunity. The Canucks showing their puck patience here. Score 2-0 Vancouver. But wait. Off this next faceoff, Murray tries to clear the puck, but he clears the boards. Delay of gain, 5-on-3. Are you with me here? 9 seconds later. 3-0 Vancouver, and oh, how the tide can change. Four shots, three goals, 1 minute, 55 seconds. The stage is set for a huge third. And just 6 minutes into the third period, check out this thing of beauty. Off the faceoff, the set play. Up the ice we go. Henrik being Henrik, nothing but patience. And at the very last second, he dishes to Alex Burrows. It's 4-0 on that beauty. Henrik's fourth point of the game. I think I could have scored on that pass. Sharks answer back with a, okay, I couldn't. We're not dead yet. Here, look at it. It's Vlasic with the shot. Desjardins gets credit. San Jose on the board. It's 4-1. And the crowd is back into this one. And just when the Canucks fans were ready to say, put a fork in those shots, Sharks not so fast. 4 minutes to play, and Ryan Clough gets one to go. Make this a two-goal game. It's 4-2 Vancouver, but the clock would wind down. That would be as close as the Sharks would get. Canucks hold on to capture the big Game 4 victory. 4-2 is the final. Kessler, Salah with a pair, Burrows. Yeah, Vancouver Canucks one game away from the Stanley Cup Finals, and the 3 second period goals set a new Canuck team record for fastest three in playoff history today. 1 minute, 55 seconds. That beats the 2 minute and 18 second record that was set back in April of 1989 versus the Calgary Flames. Let's go back to the rink live now, where Shane Foxman is standing by with more. Shane.
Thanks very much, Jody. And as you mentioned, tonight, all about the special teams, or I should say this morning or this afternoon, all about the special teams. And what a crazy game. I'm sure fans in Vancouver were watching. And as the first four or five penalties were called all against the Canucks, everybody probably saying, what's wrong with the officiating? The referees are terrible. And then, of course, the Canucks get the next five calls. And then all of a sudden, everything's changed completely. So the Canucks got full value tonight. And Chris Tanev and Keith Ballard slipping into the lineup and really did a great job, both them. I think when you say you don't notice them on the ice for any bad reasons, that's a good thing. Ballard with that great hip check seemed to also energize the guys as well. Also, as far as the game goes, it's amazing when you think about the shots on goal, and we've been looking at this and scratching our head. The Canucks outshot 35-13. When have you ever seen a team get outshot 35-13 in a playoff game and yet win the game? It really is something. We've been talking to the guys in the room. Obviously, everyone talking about special teams. They really were special tonight. The penalty kill was absolutely fantastic, and the power play, which struggled in the last game. Thanks, Coach. It struggled in the last game. Also, seemed to find its groove today. I believe I did say hi to the coach. Let's send it back. We're just going to continue to gather some information, and we'll get back to you very shortly, Jody.
Hopefully, Coach Elambeño is heading to the press conference room. We will, of course, take you back there live as soon as the coaches' pressers begin. We have Karin Larsen here standing by to analyze some of what went on into today's game. We all want to say tonight's game, but today's game, a huge one, obviously, for the Vancouver Canucks. And we all know what we'll be doing on Tuesday night back here at Rogers Arena. The Vancouver Canucks with an opportunity to eliminate the San Jose Sharks and advance to the Stanley Cup Final. So much more to come here on Seeking Stanley. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back after a quick break. Welcome back to the CBC Vancouver studios, everybody. I'm Jody Vance. Settle in as your extended Canucks playoff post-game show Seeking Stanley continues. We take you back to the Shark Tank where Shane Foxman is standing by with Kelly Rudy. Shane.
Thanks very much, Jody. It is Kelly Rudy from Hockey Night in Canada. And just your first impression of a very strange game, it seemed like.
Very strange, but there's almost a pattern. We kind of knew what was going to happen. You know, San Jose, they get all those power plays in the first period, and you had the feeling that if they weren't going to get any goals in that, that was going to come back to harm them. Of course, it did. But I also was a little bit surprised by San Jose in that first period. When they had the power plays, they didn't have as much urgency as I expected. I would have expected more pucks to the net. Now, they didn't play badly, just that Vancouver, Luongo was steady. That's all he needed to be. Didn't have to steal any game today. But then Vancouver, as deadly as they are on the power play, you know, you give them those sort of chances. And that was so bizarre, the three consecutive 5-on-3s. I don't think I've ever seen that in hockey in a close game. Maybe in a blowout where at the end, you know, maybe you're slashing and trying to get redemption that way. But it was just a weird game. And, you know, I was talking to Glenn Healy afterwards, and as you know, his vantage point is right by the Zamboni entrance, and I was marveling at how patient the Sedins are with the puck. And he said, you know, it's even more amazing, Kelly, when you're at that point right by the ice, because you see all the big bodies around. It looks as though there might be two or three guys right in their face, and yet they still have the patience and the wherewithal to find an open man. And he said, it's so amazing.
The power play, as you mentioned, it seems like this series is all about special teams. Canucks seem to be a better team 5-on-5, and the only chance the Sharks get for offense is on the power play. Canucks, flip side, they struggled in game two, but tonight they had everything working, and Sammy Salo was just exceptional. They got his shot clear, and it seemed to do the damage.
Yeah, you know, that's the advantage of having a guy with a big bomb like that at the point, because it scares everybody. And then on that one, the very first goal, he has that shot. Maybe there's a little bit too much traffic, and yet he has the knowledge to know that right here, just to my left, is Kessler, and he's got another great one-timer. So it's a deadly power play. And I also think that Torres, I know Don Cherry is talking post-game about Torres and how great he played. I thought I would agree with that. He seems to have found his focus again, and it's great to see.
What about Chris Tanev, a rookie playing his first game? And Keith Ballard, for that matter, too. These guys have been watching and watching and probably chomping at the bit, especially Ballard, to get in the game. What did you think of their play tonight?
I thought it was really, really steady. Ballard did everything that he needed to do. I didn't see any glaring mistakes, and that's a great thing. If you're sometimes as a defenseman, if you're not noticed, that's a good thing because you're not chasing. And I thought Tanev just really displayed his puck-moving abilities, and he's so calm out there. And he's a pretty impressive young player.
Let me ask you something right there. Coach AV is walking by. He seems very loose on his way by to his news conference. He taps me on the shoulder while we're on. That says a lot about kind of the sense of where the team's at, doesn't it?
That absolutely says everything about it. At this point, when you're here, you should expect a relaxed atmosphere, a relaxed team. And I think it all comes from your coach, because when you're in that dressing room, and even though you've won, your emotions are raw and you have all your senses are alive, it's great when you're around your upper management and your coaching staff and they seem relaxed, because that's what it does to you. It puts you in a relaxed state. And the same would apply for San Jose, though, because I know that they've worked really hard at ensuring that their players are in the proper mindset. And you think a lot of it goes back to the Detroit philosophy. Every time I've been amazed, every time I've been around Detroit in a big game, Ken Holland and everybody below him, they're relaxed. And it really sends a great message. So it's great to see Vigneault that way as well.
I want to quickly ask you one other thing. We talk about the strange game. Canucks had 13 shots. 13 shots in the Western Conference Final on the road, and they skate away with the win. That just adds to the bizarreness of the game.
Well, it sets up an interesting Tuesday night, I can tell you that much, because when you're a goaltender and like Niemi, and although he had no fault whatsoever on the four goals, you're not too excited when you look up and you see I've let in four goals on 13 shots. So you can expect that on Tuesday night he's going to be lights out. So I'd prepare, if I'm Vancouver, let's get pucks to the net early, lots of traffic to make it really hard on him right now, because I expect he's going to have his best game in the series.
And you just mentioned, I'll ask you quickly about the next game. The Canucks seem to have learned a lesson maybe in that Chicago series where they had a team down and didn't finish them off, and they kind of let them back in. They played better against Nashville. It only took them two games to knock them out once they got to three. Does that carry over? Do you think they're really aware of, we don't want to come back here?
Well, they'll definitely bring it up. Now, you don't want to bring it up too much, though. You don't want them to worry about it and, oh boy, if we get down 1-0 or 2-0 and then, you know, start thinking too much. But the great thing about good winning teams is that when they, as you said, once they get their foot in your throat, they don't let up. But having said that, playoff hockey throws us a lot of curveballs, so you never know what to expect again.
No, crazy tonight. Listen, Kelly, thanks so much for your time. We really appreciate it. Thank you very much, and we'll see you in Vancouver. Before we send it back to the studio, let's do our quick contest. And it's funny how today we kind of had a sense. We were talking about Sammy Salo before the game, and look what he did tonight, two goals and an assist. So tonight, a chance to win the cool Canuck gear from Lancaster Vintage, all that retro gear. We want to know, how many goals did Sammy Salo score in his best NHL season? How many goals did Sammy Salo score in his best NHL season? He wears number 6. We'll multiply it by 3 and take the 18th correct response at shane.foxman@cbc.ca. shane.foxman@cbc.ca. We'll send it back to.
And now you're doing math with the contest. We have to keep count. Okay, 18th emailer. Thanks very much, Shane. And we'll bring in Karin Larsen now to talk about more of what went on in this afternoon's game. And Karin, I'm wondering if that that shot that Coach V gave Shane in the hallway might have constituted or garnered a penalty in the first period today.
It may have, Jody, and that was interesting you should mention that, because that really seemed to set the stage. The Canucks, of course, came out into this game and said, we are not going to do what we did in Game 3, take all those minor penalties and put ourselves in trouble and have to be on the PK all the time. And what do? They come out, Tanner Glass, 10 seconds into the game? Four minors in the first period, a fifth consecutive one for by Dan Hamhuis in the second period. And the Canucks just seemed like they weren't getting it going. But then the penalty call tide seemed to turn, as you knew it probably will.
Right.
And before you knew it, well, it was Groundhog Day for the San Jose Sharks, and a really bad one over and over again. Let's go to the tape of the three goals here, because it's really interesting to see how similar all three of them look.
Can we see those goals?
Guys, do you have?
You know what's really funny is that there we go.
So here we go. This is the first one, and Kessler's going to one-time it past Niemi. Makes it 1-0. And then they get another 5-on-3. And Salo, who plays a position where you would often see Christian Ehrhoff on the first unit power play, is going to get the puck on his stick, and he's going to one-time it past Niemi. And then the third one, I think, was the fastest one, 9 seconds after the faceoff. Look, the 5-on-3 wasn't clicking for the Canucks in Game 3. They had a couple of chances they couldn't capitalize on, and I love the way Henrik said, well, yeah, we just had to get the pucks through, and they got the pucks through. And here it goes back to Salo, one-timer, back of the net. What a fantastic two-minute stretch for the Canucks, absolutely, just to take over these games. Look at Todd McClellan. He looks like he's been run over by a bus at that point. Canucks make it 3-0 in the second period. We have to talk about Henrik as well, because not only is he leading the NHL scoring race with 19 points, two ahead of anyone else, I believe he's also just passed Jeff Courtneau for Canucks' right. all-time playoff scoring. Sorry about that, Jeff, if you're over in Victoria watching. So he's passed Groning, Cliff, right. our good friend on this show, and Courtneau, and he's sneaking up on Pavel Bure as well. Trevor Linden still about 30 points ahead, but Henrik Sedin absolutely all-world with four assists in today's game.
Interesting, all the naysayers on the Sedins on Twitter yeah. are now, you know, taking a big moment of pause.
Right.
But also, in that first period, there were a lot of tweets going on about how horrible the officiating was. Interesting, those tweets stopped in the second.
The conspiracy theory.
Yeah.
They're all against us. Well, maybe not so much.
Interesting. Karin, we'll be back with you in just a moment. But first, let's head down to the rink again. As I understand, the coach who appeared to have, what did you say, be run over by a bus? Todd McClellan, take you to the podium. Let's have a listen in.
So your power play, you came in today 46%. Was this something that, an adjustment that they made today, that was the difference, or was it just your execution?
Well, I think the game itself was played, in my opinion, in three different phases. And the first phase of the game was when we had our power play opportunities, and we obviously weren't very sharp. You know, they tightened things up. They stood at their line a little bit better. But when you look at our execution, our passing, our face-off opportunities to win pucks, we started breaking out all the time. And you have to, when you're against the number one penalty kill in the league, you have to be sharp, and we weren't. And it was as simple as that. And as you start rolling, you get more and more frustrated. You start to do, you start to press a little bit, and it snowballs, and it gets worse and worse.
Todd, just over here on your left, just, can you update us on Thornton's situation, please?
I can't right now. We'll see once I get an update.
Todd, just your thought on the 3 5-on-3s, if you've ever seen that before, and your thought on the calls, maybe.
Well, the calls were, you know, I guess first of all, the 5-on-3 situation. I didn't like the penalties that originated. Heater's penalty, a turnover at the line, and we take the hook. Mitchie's penalty was a penalty he reached in. And then it snowballs from there. In 2.5 minutes, we kept marching to the box. They kept scoring, and you know, it's hard to argue the too many men on the ice penalty, and it's certainly hard to argue the shooting the puck out of the play. So there's nothing we can, you know, I can't sit here and whine and bitch about the officiating, because it had absolutely nothing to do with it. It was the team in the white that created that mess.
Todd, you're referring to three phases of the game. I think you only got through one.
You know, the first phase obviously was the lack of execution. We weren't sharp. Power play, you know, sucked some of the life out of our team, obviously. But we got to the, you know, we got to the break. We were coming out on another power play. We talked about a little bit, and there again, we don't execute. We don't do what we want to do. And then after that, we get into that penalty kill phase, 2.5 minutes of straight 5-on-3. You know, having Salo there gave us a completely different look. We saw it late in the 5-on-3, but a right-handed shot and a one-timer off the side that they like to work. You've got to find ways to get in those lanes, but he shifted well. And then the third phase of the game was, I thought, where we started to play. We started to compete, not compete, because we just weren't sharp, but we had nothing to do with competing. We got a lot sharper. You know, we threw everything we had at them, but you're not giving up 3 5-on-3 power play goals against that team and coming back. It's just not happening.
Todd, right in the middle. When you talk about right in the middle.
I'm sorry.
When you talk about not being sharp, is that just a mental thing? Do you ascribe that to? Would that be a physical thing too?
I wish I had the answer, Tim. You know, you could see it. We got what we wanted. We got some energy. We got the crowd into it. We earned opportunities on the power play. And then you could see the passes. We just watched a couple of them again. The passing was off. The receiving was off. The timing was off. There wasn't much rhythm. I have to believe some of that's mental. Some of it's physical. You know, combination of both.
Todd, you often talk about how your team likes to play with its backs against the wall. What are you going to tell them about Game 5?
Well, there's probably not a lot I have to tell them. Their backs are against the wall as hard as they can be, or as close as they can be. You know, we kind of laid it on the line in the third period tonight, that third phase, if you will, and that's what we'll be looking to do in Vancouver. We know we've got a tough task ahead of us, but Vancouver knows, we know, Detroit knows, Chicago knows that anything can happen.
A little bit along those same lines, Coach. Is the bigger challenge mental preparation or adjustments or the
game? It's always itself? Both. It's always both. We'll, we've got to clean some parts of our game up. Obviously, the power play has to be better. When you get those opportunities, you have to at least take advantage of one, maybe two of them, and it has to be better. So we'll look at that. But we've got a little bit of time here over the next day or two to regroup and to get ready to play.
Yeah, I know you've tried different ways to get this team prepared for games. Why weren't they ready at the start today in terms of being ready to execute like that? And what do you do before game five?
I think I answered that for Tim earlier. I don't have the answer for that. Obviously, if I did, we would be well on our way and we wouldn't have been that sloppy early in the game. Individuals have to prepare properly. The coaching staff's responsible for having the team ready, having them sharp, having them alert. And like I said, we got the start we wanted. It was probably one area of the game, the power play, that really let us down.
Two more again, and then Mark. Todd, what can you say about Danny Heatley's play in this series so far?
Well, Danny Heatley can, like a lot of our players, we expect a little bit more from him. I think he has to find a way to put himself in better position on the ice to score. And we'll get that from him in game five.
Todd, effort and scheme aside, do you have the talent to win the next three games?
We're going to find out.
San Jose Sharks head coach Todd McClellan addressing the media at the Shark Tank in San Jose. Vancouver Canucks winning game four, 4-2. It's a big victory for the Canucks. We have much more to come for you. We've got to take a quick break here on Seeking Stanley, but top up the beverage and meet us right back here. Coach V is up next. Shane Foxman is busy gathering player clips from in both dressing rooms. We'll have that for you in just a matter of moments. Stay tuned as Seeking Stanley continues on CBC Vancouver right after this.
Here's Henry. Kessler's over the other side of the net. Daniel walks in the middle. Salo scores! Plays the puck to Salo. One-timer scores! Back-to-back 5-on-3 goals and a 2-0 lead in San Jose. The Canucks don't get past Kinnerites. Colleen shot the button. On the 5, Jamie McGinn. Powered right down and took him out. Jamie McGinn did a couple of somersaults. Got LaPierre. There's a big blast by Rafi Torres, and he's going to get a penalty.
Look at Murray, his head down, and just an absolute explosion by Torres.
Big hits and special teams, the story of Game 4 in San Jose. Canucks are winners 4-2 and now lead this series 3-1 over the San Jose Sharks. Thanks for hanging out for more Canucks playoff postgame coverage live from CBC Vancouver. This is Seeking Stanley, and I'm Jody Vance. Let's take you back to the rink where Shane Foxman is standing by. Shane, you were speaking to some of the players. What did they have to say?
Well, as you would have think, Jody, everyone talking about special teams. The penalty kill was absolutely outstanding, and the power play on the flip side also doing all kinds of damage. The Canucks with 3 power play goals, but that came after they had to kill off 4 or 5 straight Shark power plays, and Tanner Glass taking a penalty 30 seconds into the game, and I'm sure fans, as we talked about earlier, were going, oh no, here we go again. But the Canucks found a way to fight it off and weather the storm, and it actually seemed to strengthen them. Every time they seemed to get another penalty, it almost seemed like they were saying it's us against the world, and the penalty kill got more and more aggressive, and the Sharks, as Kelly Rudy mentioned, no urgency whatsoever. Kept thinking like, yeah, our chance will come. Well, it never came. The Canucks doing all their damage, and again, 6 shots in the first, the Canucks, 4 shots in the second, and just 3 in the third, yet here they are, 1 win away from the Stanley Cup Final. As you mentioned, we talked to the players, and the first thing on everybody's mind was, yeah, special teams.
I think when you can kill that many off in a row, it builds momentum for us. That's what we did. We survived the first, and you know, we got our opportunities and we made them pay.
Okay, did Sal look on the point there in the first unit?
Yeah, I think last game we had a pretty lengthy 5-on-3 and those guys were diving in the way of his shot. And I think they probably smartened up a little bit and figured out that he's got the hardest shot in the league and weren't as brave this time around and put a couple big goals in for us.
Kevin, how about the composure of this team and the fact that you guys made the most, but not a lot out there? You only had 13 shots on points, but 3 of the first 4 shots in the second.
Yeah, again, we took what they gave us, and what they gave us in the first was a lot of power plays. So we didn't get too down on the bench. We didn't complain to the referees. We stuck with it. We had some big penalty kills for us, and like I said, that built momentum for us.
Is it tough not to think about the fact that you're 60 minutes and 1-1 away from playing for the Stanley Cup?
Yeah, I think everyone realizes that the last one's the hardest. We've learned that better than anybody, so we're looking forward to the next game.
Well, you heard Kevin Bieksa. We learned it as well as anybody. Of course, we're alluding to the Chicago series where they had the Blackhawks virtually down and out, but let them crawl back into the series. Nashville a little bit better, up 3-1. Took six games, but still better than going to seven. We'll see if the Canucks can do even better this time around come game five. Now, as mentioned, the power play outstanding tonight. Three of the four Canuck goals coming on the power play, and that usually means a big night for the Sedins, and that was the case. Henrik, of course, with four helpers, and Daniel with 3 points. And after the game, him too, like everybody else, can't say enough about the special teams.
I was looking up in the third and I saw the same thing. I was a little bit surprised, but at the same time, we got those. We killed a lot of power, a lot of PK in the first, and then we got all those 5-on-3s in the second, where we scored all those goals, and then we were just kind of not sitting back, but we didn't really push to make something happen.
One win from the Stanley Cup Final. That must be interesting.
Yeah, but
think about.
Yeah, but it's a big game. I think we've been in this position before, and we need to put our best game on the ice.
We've never been in this position before.
No, but we gotta kill this series, and it's gonna be a tough game.
Kill this series. Just the words.
Yeah, Swedish. That's why. No, I mean it's all. Both home games has been tough. You look at our second game too. It's tight going into third. We run away with a score, but other than that, it's been tough games.
You scored 1 5-on-3 goal the whole season, and it came like the last couple of weeks.
Yeah, but we
had three tonight.
Yeah, I know, but we.
What was the trouble then? What was?
No, we didn't have any 5-on-3s in the regular season. If you look at the stats, I mean, we probably had 3 or 4 20-second ones. So now we get 3 or 4 2-minute ones, and that's the big difference.
How much of a weapon is Sammy back there? And, I mean, he's there for Christian, right?
No, he's deadly. And we get the right-handed shot, too, which opens up a lot of things. And when he can get that shot through, it's gonna go in the back of the net. So it's a good feeling having him back there.
And sometimes, as you heard from Daniel Cena, it doesn't even matter if Sammy gets the shot. Just having him back there kind of forces the defense to acknowledge that he's there. And you saw that's what led to Ryan Kessler's first power play goal. They were out on Sammy. He slides it over to Ryan Kessler, and he does the damage. Next time it's 5-on-3, they can't keep a man at the point, and that allowed Sammy Salo to just kind of wind up and blast them. And you saw 2 goals in a matter of about 20 seconds or so. Before we send it back, Jody, just one other quick stat. We talk about no shots on goal, really, for the Canucks. Second period, they had 4 shots. They scored on their first three shots of the period found their way to the back of the net, and they only end up with 4. It's very rare, as we said, a team to have 13 shots in 60 minutes of play and win the game, but the Canucks will take it, as we say, one win away from the Stanley Cup Final. Let's go back to the studio.
Thanks, Shane, and let's take you to the press room at the Shark Tank where Canucks head coach Ellen Vigneault is speaking. Let's listen in.
Is that them that maybe caught them off guard on that 5-on-3, and then Sammy's shot was available, and we used it twice real quickly, and it worked.
Alain, when you get a parade of penalties like that on both sides, is there any way to predict a game like that? Is all the strategies that you go into a game with kind of go out the window?
Well, obviously, in any hockey game, you prepare your power play and your penalty killing. We kill the penalties that we have to kill at the beginning. I thought that gave us a little bit of momentum and confidence. And then, the 5-on-3s that we got, one, the referee has to call, too many men on the ice, it's obvious. And the other one, they shot over the glass. So referees didn't really have to make those calls. I mean, they're automatics. And our 5-on-3 did what it was supposed to do.
Coach, can you talk about Henrik's ability, obviously, to set up? We've seen it all season long for years, but in this game in particular.
Yeah, I mean, Henrik's probably biggest asset is the fact that he can see plays and make plays when there's a lot of pressure. And again, that tonight, that line did that for us. They're our offensive players, and we need them to produce, and they did tonight.
Coach, all season long, you said your team has been very good at just being able to focus on the game at hand. This next game is obviously a big one, given what it means if you can win it. You confident your group can can put that out of their minds.
Give me a half an hour to have a little bit of fun here, and then ask me no more about that. Okay, I want to enjoy this a little bit here. But to answer your question, I am very confident about that.
And the PK, the start of the series, gave up five power play goals to the Sharks, and then since then pretty much shut them down. What has been a difference?
You know, sometimes that happens. I mean, I thought, we gave up four power play goals to them on four shots. We were in good position. We were doing the right things. You know, whether it be our power play or their power play, it just clicks for whatever reason. And, we were able to fight through that because obviously that's challenging. And tonight we were really tested early. And our guys were able to respond and get the job done.
Coach, you go with Tanev and Ballard today. Just your thoughts on their play, their contributions.
Yeah, I thought both of them, considering, the stage, I thought both of them played well. I had a really tough decision to make there, not dressing Andrew Alberts. I told him before the game, Andrew's a great individual, and it was really a tough thing for me to tell him. But at the end of the day, I wanted a right defenseman, a guy that's used to playing the right side, and neither Keith or Andrew have played a lot of right side. So when Chris was called on to play for us this year, he played real well, and I thought Keith played his best hockey with Chris, so that's why I made that decision.
Coach, can you just comment? Apparently over 4,000 Vancouver Canuck fans have come down here. Can you just comment about it?
That's phenomenal. I mean, in warm-up and during the anthem, to hear our fans in an American city chant O Canada the way they were doing, it was just incredible. It reminded me a lot of when we went on that California swing, Anaheim, L.A., and ended up in Phoenix, where I think we had something like between 5,000 and 10,000 fans following us. So really appreciate the support we're getting right now. Shout.
Coach, can you talk a little bit about Salo's role tonight? Obviously the two goals, but he did take on a lot more responsibility than last time.
Yeah, I mean, he logged some very important minutes. Sammy is one of our veteran players. He's been here for a long time. Very important part of our core group. And, I think he understands that, you don't get to too many opportunities, or maybe he doesn't have a lot of opportunities left considering that he's getting a little bit older. So, obviously, he is very motivated right now, playing real well for us. Nobody's going to ask me about my goalie. No? Thanks, guys.
Oh, good times with Coach V. After a win, it's even just a little bit more fun because I think the fans, Karin, really made Coach's night tonight, or afternoon, I guess. Feels like an evening game, but a noon start, so odd, but right. They were there early, they were there en masse,
yes.
The fans playing a big role in this one.
And they were here on our plaza as well, Jody. A coffee croissant and a heaping helping of the Vancouver Canucks for lunch, or brunch, I guess you could call it today. Let's take a look at the fans on the plaza. We've had thousands out there come down to watch the game on our big screen outside, but there was one particular guy. He's coming up here pretty soon, absolutely enterprising, because somehow he happens to own that larger than life shark.
Holy
and
fish.
A crane and a pickup truck, and he drove it down in front of our CBC Vancouver building. You see a few teeth missing, and then love this, Johnny Canuck going to work on the dummy shark, and that's exactly what happened on the ice tonight in San Jose. Nicely done by the local fans here in Vancouver. And as you heard Navy's press conference, 4,000 Canuck fans on hand at the shark tank. It was all great fun there. But then the anthem starts. We're going to play a little bit of this because, Jody, you tell me, is this the worst anthem ever?
Oh, Canada, we stand on guard for
so I'm telling you, sucked the life right out of the building. That guy is no Mark Donnelly. Even Jamel Myers had to wake himself up after that. Let's compare the hair. Sharks fan, curly, Canucks fan, blue and kind of, I don't know, Frist 80s rock. Out. Yeah, there's another one. But here's my favorite, the teal and orange men. I've been emailing with the green men. They are very upset about this. And look at this guy. He's like that guy in grade three when all the kids put the sheet over their head and go to Halloween party as a ghost.
Casper, yeah.
Yeah, he comes as the full-on, I don't know, whole Disney cast with his mom who stayed up until the middle of the night sewing that costume. Anyway.
But you know, he can't drink beer.
Of course not.
There's a
little bit of the lighter side of today's game.
Very cool. The fans definitely showing their support for the Vancouver Canucks. Coach V all over it today, and they got what they deserved in terms of the victory. Got to remind you, a 4-2 win for the Vancouver Canucks in Game 4. Of course, Game 5 goes on Tuesday evening, 6 o'clock puck drop. We have to take a quick break here on Seeking Stanley, but we'll be right back in just a matter of moments as we have more reaction from the rink. Karin and I hanging out here in the CBC Vancouver studios. Top up the beverage. Meet us back here. More Canuck talk in moments. Stay with us. The No Way Jose's will be out in full force, no question, Tuesday evening when the puck drops on Game 5 here at Rogers Arena. The Vancouver Canucks with an opportunity to oust the San Jose Sharks. Welcome back to the CBC Vancouver studios, everyone. This is Seeking Stanley, your destination for those who just can't get enough of Canada's only team still fighting for the NHL's ultimate prize. I'm Jody Vance, and we take you back to the rink now. Shane Foxman, you've been very busy gathering player reaction this afternoon.
No, and as you would expect, Jody, so much to say after a game like that. We heard Kelly Rudy call it strange. I've heard the words bizarre in so many different ways. You know, the Canucks kill off 5 straight Shark power plays and erupt for 3 power play goals of their own. But I'll tell you what, maybe the biggest goal of the game, though, came from Alex Burrows in the third, as it turned out, when the Sharks rallied for a couple. That fourth goal for the Canucks, their only even strength goal, which finished off a beautiful pass from Henrik Sedin. You don't see a pass like that where it goes through the goalie's legs. And then, of course, Alex at Jam at home. Afterwards, we talked to Alex, and he also talking about the great job that special teams did today.
They're not going to quit easy. They're a team that have a lot of experience and a lot of quality players, and they're not going to throw the towel that easily. And I'm sure they're going to regroup and prepare for a big Game 5, but we'll have to do the same thing, re-energize and refocus and make some adjustments and get ready to go.
Special teams certainly the key, penalty kill and then the execution on the power play.
Yeah, obviously that was huge. We talked about it. If we had to take some penalties, we talked about making some adjustments, and we did tonight. And when we broke down, Lou made some big saves, but I think we were more committed at blocking shots and really battling hard on the PK to get that puck down the ice and killing those penalties. And on the power play, as a group, we kind of felt that we didn't do the job in Game 3 when we had the chance to go on a 5-on-3 and to get the team back in the game in the second period last game. And we talked about it a little bit, and it was nice to get a chance again tonight to go 5-on-3, and especially 3 times in a row there. And if you give Henrik that much time to make plays, he's going to find the open men. And we had great shooters there on that power play, and it was nice to see.
Alex Burrows, of course, scoring the Canucks' 4th goal tonight. Now, so much made about the blue line coming into tonight. Of course, Christian Ehrhoff, a no-go. Aaron Roma, no-go. That meant Keith Ballard and Chris Tanev checked into the lineup. A little bit of a surprise that Chris Tanev played and not Andrew Alberts, but they decided to go with the right-handed shot with Tanev, and Tanev and Ballard were paired together, and we've talked about it already tonight. You didn't really notice them on the ice, which is a good thing. Ballard, though, with the great hip check. So after the game, of course, we talked to Dan Hamm, who spends a lot of time, obviously, with Keith Ballard and Chris Tanev, and got his sense on what the guys brought to the table today.
You know, I was really happy with our focus and not getting too rattled with all the penalty calls against us, and we did a good job of killing them.
When you have those advantages, those 5-on-3 advantages, just to strike maybe early as you guys did in those chances.
Yeah, that was huge for us. You know, it might have made a difference in last game. We took a look at some things, made some adjustments, and you know, what a difference it made in tonight's game. And of course, yeah, I mean, getting them early in the power play is huge. You still got another minute and a half in the other one, so big turning point.
So the Canucks obviously taking one perception of the game. Special teams were absolutely the key to their victory. And the flip side, in the other room, special teams led to the Sharks' demise in Game 4. Now they find themselves one loss away from being eliminated as they got all the way to the conference finals yet again. So a lot of pressure on the Sharks. And afterwards, we had a chance to hear from Patrick Marleau.
They have a tough job, but we can't put ourselves in those situations where they make a choice to call a penalty. So we need more.
Can you talk about the immediacy of this thing, the urgency of this thing now, down 3-1? It's pretty obvious what you have to do.
Yeah, we got to play another game. So it's our focus on winning one game at a time and go from there.
The power play obviously had problems.
Obviously, a very discouraged bunch tonight in the Sharks room, and understandably so. It's not just that they lost, it's that they had a golden opportunity, especially in the first period. We said Tanner Glass takes a penalty 30 seconds in. They had five straight power plays and could not find a way to get the puck past Roberto Luongo, and as it turns out, that is the biggest difference in the game. Let's head back to the studio. Jody?
And thanks, Shane. Yeah, we're going to continue on the Luongo topic, Karin. We have to talk about the play of the Canucks netminder.
Yeah, absolutely. Fantastic. Or was he just steady? I mean, that's the
very
debate.
Steady.
He was as good as he needed to be. Roberto Luongo stopped 33 of 35 shots on net tonight. His save percentage in the game, 9.43. That's compared to Niemi, who stopped only 9 of 13. His save percentage, 0.692. Not very good. Hey, Louis stopped 15 of 17 in the third period, and that's when the Sharks really started to push. And you saw AV come out in his presser and say at the end, isn't anyone going to ask me about my goalie? The sense being that the only time he talks about Luongo is when he's passed the puck to Joe Thornton and Thornton's put it behind him or someone scored on him from behind the goal. But listen, Louis was really good tonight. He gets paid $10 million a year. He should be good, and that's why sometimes he's such a lightning rod for criticism, because he is one of the highest paid players in the NHL. But he came through for the Canucks tonight. I have a feeling, though, his big moment could come here on Tuesday night for Game 6.
Be interesting. It is a 6 p.m. puck drop on Game 5.
That's right.
On Tuesday evening, we're going to take a quick break here on Seeking Stanley, but we are coming back with more from the rink in San Jose and from here in the CBC Vancouver studios. Stay with us. Hey there, welcome back to the CBC Vancouver studios for the Sunday edition of Seeking Stanley, your home of extended Canucks playoff post-game coverage. For those who just can't get enough of Canada's lone remaining playoff team, let's go back to the rink now. Shane Foxman, for your final thoughts, sir.
Thanks very much, Jody. And you know what? Two stats stick out for me tremendously. Of course, one deals with the power play. So much made of the Sharks' power play heading into tonight. They were 6 for 13 coming into tonight's game. Now 6 for 18 as the Canucks were able to kill off all five Shark power plays in this one. And on the flip side, the Canucks with just 13 shots on net. I'm having a tough time getting my head around that you could have 13 shots on goal in a playoff game in the Western Conference Final and you still skate away with the win. Three goals on four shots in the second period. I'll tell you what, let's get to our contest. And how fortuitous was it for us to pick Sammy Salo this morning as our main man, and he really arrived and lived up to the expectations, two goals and an assist tonight. So our question was, if you wanted to win all that cool Lancaster vintage gear, you can only get it at the Canucks team store at the Rogers Arena, and of course if you're watching Seeking Stanley, our question tonight was how many goals did Sammy Salo score in his best NHL season? His best NHL season. Our winner tonight, Karin Kelly. She knew that Sammy scored 14 goals in the 2006-2007 season. Congratulations to Karin, and we will have someone contact you about how you can pick up your prizes. And in the meantime, Jody, as we said, Canucks now just one win away from the Stanley Cup Final. Let's head back to the studio.
All right, Shane, travel safely, my friend. We'll see you back here in studio on Tuesday, because that's the next game at Rogers Arena, Tuesday at 6 p.m. here on CBC, of course, on Hockey Night in Canada. Immediately following the game, you will find us right here on Seeking Stanley. There's the information that you need in order to make sure you're in the right place at the right time. That does it for this edition of Seeking Stanley, live from the CBC studios in Vancouver. Remember, we follow every playoff game as the Canucks continue their march toward the holy grail of hockey. For Karin Larsen, Shane Foxman, everybody working behind the scenes here, thank you for joining us. And the Vancouver Canucks collecting one more puck. You need 16 of them to get to that holy grail of hockey, and they collected one more in a big game in San Jose. Back here Tuesday, 6 o'clock puck drop on Hockey Night in Canada. I'm Jody Vance. Make it a great day.